Hey friends, welcome to the YouTube channel All About Electronics. So in this video and the upcoming series of videos, we will learn about the sequential circuits. Now if you see any digital circuit which is used in our day-to-day life, then it consists of both combinational as well as the sequential circuits. So first, let us understand the basics of the sequential circuit and let us understand how is it different from the combinational circuits. So in the digital electronics, all the circuits which we have discussed so far were the combinational circuits. For example, the encoder decoder or the adder and subtractor circuits which we have discussed so far were the combinational circuits. So in this type of circuits, the output of the circuit only depends on the present inputs. For example, if we take the case of the full adder, then it consists of 3 inputs and 2 outputs. So if the input to this full adder are 0 1 0, then the corresponding output are 1 and 0. That means the sum output will be 1, while the carry output will be equal to 0. On the other end, if the inputs are 1 1 0, then the corresponding sum output will be equal to 0, while the carry output will be equal to 1. So of course, after applying the inputs, these outputs will be available after the propagation delay of this logic circuit. But this output solely depends on the present input, and it has nothing to do with the past inputs. But if you see any sequential circuits, then in this circuit, the output not only depends on the present inputs, but it also depends on the past inputs. That means here, the output is the function of the present inputs as well as the past inputs. And since it is the function of the past inputs, so this sequential circuit has to have some memory element. So to understand it, let us take one simple example. So let's say we have one television and we want to change the channel of this television using the remote. So to change the channel, as soon as we press the channel up button on the remote, then the channel will get incremented by 1 and the next channel will be shown to us. For example, if the current channel which is being watched is the channel number 8, then after pressing the button, the next channel will be 9. Likewise, if the current channel which is being watched is the channel number 15, then after pressing the button, the next channel will be 16. So if we compare this analogy with the sequential circuits, then here, this channel up button is our input. Because without pressing this channel up button, we will not be able to see the next channel. But after pressing this button, what will be the next channel? That depends on the present channel. That means if the present channel is 15, then the next channel will be 16. Or if the present channel is 8, then the next channel will be 9. So here, this next channel number not only depends on the present input, but it also depends on the current channel which is being watched. That means here, after pressing the button, to go to the next channel, we also need to store the present channel in the memory. And the same thing is also applicable to the sequential circuits. So this is the basic block diagram of the sequential circuits. So as you can see, this typical sequential circuit also consists of the combinational circuit block. But along with that, the memory elements are also connected in the feedback path. So this memory element stores the information in the binary form. So as you can see, the output of the sequential circuit depends on the present input as well as what is presently stored in this memory. And in a way, what is being stored in the memory currently depends on the previous inputs. So to get the better idea, let us relate it with our earlier example. So when we press the channel up button on the remote, then that is the input to this sequential circuit. So currently, if the channel 8 is stored in the memory, then this combinational circuit will increment that number by the 1. That means now, the new output will be the 9. And in this case, now the same number will be stored in the memory. So now when the next time this channel up button is pressed, then the output will be equal to 10. Because now this number 9 is stored in the memory. That means the output of the sequential circuit is the function of the present input as well as the current state of the memory. And that is how this sequential circuit works. So basically, there are two types of sequential circuits, that is the synchronous and the asynchronous. So in the synchronous sequential circuit, the circuit responds to the input only at the discrete intervals. Or to be precise, the memory element inside the sequential circuit responds to the input only at the discrete interval of time. On the other hand, if we see these asynchronous sequential circuits, then these circuits immediately respond to the input level change. That means as soon as the input level changes, then this circuit responds to that input level change. So let us understand them one by one. And first, let us start with the asynchronous circuits. So let's say we have one asynchronous sequential circuit, and initially the input to this circuit is equal to low. Now as soon as the input level changes, then this circuit responds to that input level change. So of course, this combinational circuit block will respond to that change immediately. And after its propagation delay, it will generate the suitable output for the memory. But in this asynchronous sequential circuits, this memory element will also respond to that change immediately. And immediately, it will change its output state. So once again, now if the input level changes, then after some propagation delay, the corresponding output for this memory will also change. So this memory element will respond to that change immediately. So overall, we can say that these asynchronous sequential circuits respond to that input change immediately. On the other hand, these synchronous sequential circuits respond to the input only at the discrete interval of times. Now to respond to the input only at the discrete interval of time, this circuit also has one more input, that is the clock signal. So if you further see inside the sequential circuit, then as I said earlier, actually this memory element responds to the change in the input only at the discrete interval of time. So as you can see, as soon as the input level changes, then this combinational circuit will respond to that change immediately. And after some propagation delay, it will generate the output as well as the suitable input for these memory elements. But these memory elements respond to that change only at the discrete interval of time. Or in other words, they respond to that change as per this clock signal. So I am sure most of you are already aware about the clock signal. But those who are not aware, this clock signal is the periodic train of pulses whose value changes between the two voltage levels. And of course, in the digital electronics, this low voltage level corresponds to the logic 0, while the high voltage level corresponds to the logic 1. So basically, this clock signal is the periodic train of pulses which changes its state between the logic 1 and the logic 0. So since we are talking about the clock, so it is good to know some basic terms related to clock signal. And the first one is the time period. So the time after which the clock signal repeats itself is known as the time period of the clock signal. Similarly, the time for which the clock signal is high is known as the on time. And likewise, the time for which this clock signal remains off is known as the off time. Now for the given time period, the clock signals can have different on times and off times. And typically, it is defined by the another term which is known as the duty cycle, which is the ratio of the on time to the total time period. So with the given time period, the different clock signals can have different duty cycles. Or in other words, with the given time period, the different clock signals can have different on time and off time. For example, for some clock signal, if the duty cycle is equal to 50%, it means that its on time and off time are equal. Now, if the duty cycle of the clock signal is less than 50%, it means that its on time is less than the off time. On the other hand, if the duty cycle of the clock signal is more than 50%, it means that its on time is more than the off time. So this synchronous sequential circuit responds to the input according to the clock signal. Or to be precise, the memory element inside the sequential circuit responds to the change in the input according to this clock signal. So typically, they respond to this clock signal when this clock signal is high. Or in other words, they respond during the on time. So there are some sequential circuits which responds to the input during the entire on time of the clock signal. So these sequential circuits are known as the level triggered circuits. That means this type of sequential circuits are sensitive to the clock signal level. That means this sequential circuits responds to the input when the clock level is high. And when the clock level is low, then these circuits will not respond to the input. That means this type of sequential circuits are the level sensitive. On the other end, there are other types of sequential circuits which respond at the clock transition. So this sequential circuit which respond to the input at only the clock transitions are known as the edge-triggered sequential circuits. So these edge-triggered circuits which respond to the input only during the rising edge are known as the positive edge-triggered circuits. So basically, these positive edge-triggered sequential circuits respond to the input when there is a low to high transition in the clock signal. On the other end, these negative edge-triggered circuits respond during the falling edge. Or in other words, they respond to the input when there is a high to low transition in the clock signal. So this type of edge-triggered circuits are known as the negative edge-triggered circuits. So in this type of edge-triggered sequential circuits, the memory element inside the sequential circuit responds to the change in the input only at either rising or the falling edge. That means whatever input is present during the falling edge, this memory element will respond to that input. And once that falling or the rising edge passes, then even if the input changes, then it will not respond to that input change. And once again, it will respond only during the next clock transition. On the other end, if you see these level triggered circuits, then this type of circuit is sensitive to the clock level. So this circuit responds to the input when the clock level is high. So during this on time, even if the input changes multiple times, then also this circuit responds to that input change. But after this on time, now if the input changes, then this circuit will not respond to that input change. And once again, it will respond when the clock level will become high. So that is the basic difference between the level triggered and the edge triggered sequential circuits. So as I said earlier, when we say that the circuit responds to the input as per the clock signal, what we actually mean is that the memory element inside the sequential circuit will respond to the change in the input as per this clock signal. So as you can see, based on the input, this conventional circuit will respond to that input change immediately. But this memory element in the circuit will respond to that change only when the clock signal is high. Or if it is edge triggered, then it will respond to that change when there is a clock transition. That means the state of this memory element will change only at the clock transition. So as you can see, the output of this memory element is the function of the present input as well as the past output of this memory element. So in this type of synchronous sequential circuits, the propagation delay of the different logic gates decides the maximum clock frequency. That means as soon as the input signal is applied, then after some propagation delay, this conventional circuit will generate the input for this memory element. But this propagation delay should be lesser than the time period of the clock signal, so that when the next clock transition arrives, then the stable input is already available to this memory element. And by ensuring that, this synchronous sequential circuit can work properly. That means the propagation delay of this logic gates in the circuit will decide the maximum operating clock frequency. So as you can see, this memory element is the essential block of these sequential circuits. And the flip-flop is very basic memory element. So this flip-flop can store a 1 bit of information, which can be either 0 or 1. So once again, this flip-flop can be designed with the help of the logic gates. And with the help of these flip-flops, it is possible to build the different sequential circuits like the registers and counters. So we can say that this flip-flop is very basic building block of the sequential circuits. So in the upcoming videos, we will learn about these flip-flops in detail. But I hope in this video, you got the basic overview of the sequential circuits. So if you have any question or suggestion, then do let me know here in the comment section below. If you like this video, hit the like button and subscribe the channel for more such videos.